Students, today is hopefully my last lecture to you, and I want to finish it off with V.R. Krishna Iyer and a small yesterday I sent you a YouTube video on critical analysis of any work and how is it done, along with a PDF file of just 2 pages which shows when you're critically analyzing a text how to not summarize it but critically apprise it. So first we will get done with V.R. Krishna Iyer, and then we will move on to the critical analysis part. So M.C. Chawla, in his story, in the short story, in the short essay that is in your syllabi, talks about V.R. Krishna Iyer, and he actually eulogizes or praises this person. Let's just read about him, and if a question comes on Chawla, you can talk about M.C. Chawla as well as V.R. Krishna Iyer. Justice Vaidyanath Puranam Rama Iyer Krishna Iyer was a noted judge who became a pioneer of judicial activism in India. He pioneered the legal aid movement in the country. Before that, he was a state minister and politician. As an activist lawyer, he served jail terms for the cause of his poor and underprivileged clients. He was seen as an ardent human rights activist. In addition, he campaigned for social justice and the environment. A sports enthusiast and a prolific author, he was conferred with the Padma Vibhushan in 1999. His judgments continue to be cited in the higher judiciary. So now you know that he was a judge and why M.C. Chawla has written on him. He was one of the, he was a judicial activist as well as a judge in himself, and his judgments are cited across India in terms of their acumen and verdict. So he was a very prolific judge, and all M.C. Chawla would write about is his personal association with this judge and how to know him in a personal capacity. Now, even if you do not know that, you can talk about V.R. Krishna Iyer based on your sources of Wikipedia and other internet sources. Vaidyanath Puranam Rama Iyer Krishna Iyer was born in 1950 in Vaidyanath Puranam village in Palakkad, which was a part of the then Malabar region of the then Madras state, to a lawyer father named Rama Iyer. He inherited from his father the qualities of taking an avid interest in the community around and using the law for the benefit of those in more need. He studied law from Madras. Oh, what's the new name for Madras? And started practice in his father's chamber in 1938 at Thalassery, Malabar. In 1948, when he protested the evil of torture by police for interrogation, he was imprisoned for a month on a fabricated charge of giving legal assistance to communists. He was elected to the Madras Legislative Assembly in 1952 from Thalassery as a non-party independent candidate. He became the first Minister of Law, Justice, Home Irrigation, Power, Prisons, Social Welfare and Inland Navigation in the first communist government in Kerala, headed by E.M.S. Nambudiri Pad, that came to power in 1957. He initiated legal aid to the poor, jail reforms incorporating the rights of prisoners, and set up more courts and rescue homes for women and children. Judicial activist. He got several labor and land reforms passed. He resolved an interstate water dispute between the newly formed states Kerala and Tamil Nadu. You will recall these water disputes also came in a couple of years back as well. When this government was dismissed by the central government, he resumed legal practice in August 1959. He lost the 1965 assembly election when he again contested as an independent candidate. Let's look at his work as a judge. He was appointed a judge of the Kerala High Court in 1968. He was a member of the Law Commission from 1971 to 1973, where he drafted a comprehensive report which would lead to the legal aid movement in the country. He was elevated as Judge of the Supreme Court of India in 1973. In June 1975, the Allahabad High Court had unseated Prime Minister Indira Gandhi from the parliament and barred her from it for another 6 years. Rebuffing favour seekers, he heard a challenge to this order in the Supreme Court. He was both blamed for granting a conditional stay and praised for refusing an unconditional stay. Interpreting this as losing the popular mandate to rule, the opposition called for her resignation. The next day, she declared a state of emergency in the country. He would go on to write landmark judgments. Shamsher Singh case, which interpreted the powers of the cabinet with that of the president. Menaka Gandhi case, which paved the way to read the plain words right to life and personal liberty to mean many human rights now, thus expanding Article 21 of the Constitution. Ratlam municipality case, where he stated a trend for judges to leave the courtroom and go out and see the situation on ground. Okay, that is unprecedented. Moreover, this case would be a forerunner of cases that would be decided later on the concepts of precautionary principles, polluter pays, and sustainable development. Muthamma case, where he broke through the glass ceiling with gender parity and traditional practices in public employment. His lonely crusade against the death penalty would later on make the court impose it only in the rarest of rare cases. He brought in safeguards against custodial excesses. He made bail conditions humane and directed the government to provide free legal aid to detainees in prison facing charges. Needless to say, the man was a pioneer in so many respects with regard to Indian judicial system. And remember all of the changes that he has made and why you can now understand if MC Chawla wishes to speak about Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer. Why would that be? Because the man has fought for the have-nots since a very, very long time. With this, we will commune the end of your syllabus. As much revision as I could do, I have done. I was looking into your vocal presentations, and it is deeply disheartening that you have yet not come to terms with what exactly is a critical literary analysis. For terms of ease and use, let's just say that critical and literary analysis mean the same. Now, what is it that I am looking from you when I say critically apprise or critically do a literary criticism of the poem or do a literary or critical analysis of the novel? It means the same thing. What it does not mean is a summary of the poem. What it does not mean is a summary of the novel. What it does not mean is you telling me the plot. What it does not mean is you talking to me about a step-by-step account of what happens in the work. That fetches you 0 marks because that is not critical analysis. Most of you in your presentations have done the same. Let's go here a little bit critically. One of the first things that you're supposed to do in a critical analysis, what are the themes of the work? Themes, T-H-E-M-E-S. What is the theme? The core crux of that which the author wishes to discuss. Based on these themes, has the author accomplished the task or not? Has the writer accomplished the task or not? Critical or literary analysis also means where you disagree and with which portions of the text. Now, you need not disagree with the text at all. So, where would you agree with the text and why? Third point, situate the text in the economics and social period of its time. So, when you're talking about Ode to Immortality, not one of you has spoken about the era of Romanticism. Not one of you has spoken about the era that came before it. What was it that Wordsworth was bringing you to poetry? And what was it that in Ode to Immortality, something that has not been discussed previously in works in the preceding centuries? You have to study the social setup of those times. And it's a Wikipedia one-page read-up. If you go from Shakespeare's time, then you just have to read 4 eras. It would just take 4 days to read each era, make certain points of each era, and then situate your text within those eras. Now let's say Francis Bacon. What kind of prose works were done before Francis Bacon? Why is Francis Bacon writing an essay? What are the core points of his essay? Some of the adjectives used for his essays are terse, pithy, scientifically formulated. If they're scientifically formulated, what does that state? That before this, they weren't scientifically formulated. So Bacon is doing something unprecedented. This is critical analysis. Your own view of, I personally found the poem or I personally found the novel very nice, sweet, charming. Sorry, it's not critical analysis. What are the themes? Which portions you strongly disagree with and why? Which portions you agree with and why? What is the narratorship of the work? Omniscient narrator, first person narration, second person narration, third person narration. What is the narrative way in which it is said, in which it is written? And what does the narrative form tell you about the work? This is what a critical analysis is all about. This is what I had expected from you all. I have been ranting incessantly that a critical, even if you Google critical analysis of literature, you come up with so many works and so many PDF files on how to do it. Not one of you did it. It's very easy to ask your teacher, how is a critical analysis done? I have been telling this to you in person, how it is done, since I remember. I've already wasted 4 to 5 lectures in person with the entire class present, that it is not a basic summation, summarization of the text. And yet I receive confusions regarding, if it's not a summary, then what is critical analysis? Record this video and put it to more use. If you can fill more detailed view of themes, sub-theme, plots, subplots, what is new in the text? What is it that Shakespeare brought new to the aspect of playwriting, and is it present in Merchant of Venice and the portions that you're reading? That is what a critical analysis is all about. Yes, it requires in-depth studies from your part. There is nothing that I can help you out there with. Make diligent notes. English is not something that you will get over just by, you know, reading the text this time. So please keep these 4 or 5 yardsticks in mind when you're going for a critical / literary analysis of a work. And that's it from now. I sincerely again hope that I do not have to send you any more videos.